Good evening, respected professors and my friends. Today I am going to present a case of breast lump. A 45 years old lady by name Bubbly, who hails from Saharanpur, and she is a housewife and she belongs to low socioeconomic status, presented to our integrated breast care center with the chief complaints of painless lump in right breast for 1 month. These are the chief complaints. Coming to the history of present illness. She was apparently well 1 month ago when she noticed a pea-sized lump in her right breast accidentally during the birth, which is insidious in onset and gradually progressive and attained the present size of a bean, and there is a history of associated loss of appetite. There is no history of pain, there is no history of nipple discharge or nipple retraction, or no history of fever or trauma or loss of weight. There is no history of bone pain, jaundice, breathlessness and cough either, or no history of OCP intake or hormone replacement therapy, or no history of radiation exposure, and there is no history of swelling elsewhere in the body. This is pertaining to her history of present illness. So shall I move ahead?
Yeah,
okay. Coming to the past, there is no history of similar complaints in the past and no history of any other comorbidities like TB, hypertension, diabetes, yes, epilepsy, asthma either, or no history of any surgeries in the recent past. Coming to the personal history, she takes mixed diet and her appetite is decreased since 1 month, and the bowel and bladder habits are normal. She is non-smoker and non-alcoholic. Her sleep patterns are normal. Coming to the menstrual history, she attained menarche at 17 years of her age, and age at her fertile is 21 years. She is para 2, live 2. All are enjoying good health. Her last childbirth is 20 years ago, and she breastfed on an average of 1 year for both the child. She attained menopause 3 years ago, and previously her menstrual cycles are regular and 5/28 days cycles. Coming to the family history, there is no history of malignancies in her first degree relatives and no history of any other comorbidities in their family. Summary of my history: she is in a post-menopausal para 2 live 2 lady, 45 years old lady with painless right breast lump and loss of appetite without any comorbidities.
Okay. So what is the total duration?
Sir, of 1 month.
What is loss of weight?
Sir, no loss of weight, sir. Only loss of appetite for 1 month.
Loss of appetite only. What is, yes, the importance? No, what is the importance of the menstrual history?
Sir, because it correlates with the predisposing factors for CA breast.
Like early
menarche, late menopause.
What is early menarche?
Less than 12 years if she.
Okay, what is late menopause?
More than 55 years it is documented, sir.
No, it's not 55. It is 50, yes, years. 50 years.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Any other? You said family history. What is the importance of family history?
So there are some carcinomas will run in it may run in families, like familial carcinomas or hereditary carcinomas might be there, or some syndromic associations like Lynch syndrome or Lee Family syndromes can inherit.
Okay, any other genetic?
Sir, any BRCA mutations, BRCA1 and BRCA2 mutations in their family, so it will predispose to early presentation of breast carcinoma in these patients.
Where do you get BRCA1?
Sorry, sir?
Where do you get, which gene you get BRCA1?
The 17 chromosome, sir. On chromosome 17? Number 17.
17? 17
number 17, long arm, sir.
Q?
Yes, sir. Q long arm.
17 Q?
Yes, sir.
What is the importance of BRCA1?
Sir, it can... the majority of patients will have a triple negative breast carcinoma if BRCA is there, or 60-85% of patients will develop carcinoma in their lifetime.
Yeah, 85, maximum 85%. 85. Any other association for BRCA1?
Sir, any ovarian malignancies or endocrine malignancies?
What is the incidence of ovarian malignancy in BRCA1?
Sorry, sir, that I didn't remember.
20-40% you get ovarian malignancy.
Okay.
Any other importance for BRCA1?
The histology, it can correlate to histology, sir. The patient may have medullary carcinomas.
No, the patient will get a second malignancy in breast in 50%.
Okay.
So that is all. Do you know any important person, any VIP who got BRCA got detected and treated? Any film star or?
No, sir.
Have you heard of Angelina Jolie?
Yes, sir. I heard of it, so, but I didn't recollect it right now.
Okay, what happened to Angelina Jolie? Yes? What was done for Angelina Jolie?
Sir, am I audible?
Yeah, you are audible. What happened to Angelina Jolie? What was done for her?
Prophylactic mastectomy.
She underwent prophylactic mastectomy. Yes, sir.
Bilateral prophylactic mastectomy.
Mastectomy. She underwent. Yeah.
And followed by.
Babu sir, can you put your camera on, sir?
It's not on.
No, sir. If you go to left, lower.
And she underwent breast reconstruction also, sir.
Yeah, fine.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Yes. So, you know how many hours it took for her after the mastectomy for reconstruction? Her breast was reconstructed. You know that?
Yes, sir.
12 hours for reconstruction.
Okay, sir.
What about BRCA2?
BRCA2, there is association 60 to 80% cases the patient will develop carcinomas. And it is associated with male breast carcinoma.
Male breast cancer. How many percentage will get male breast cancer? Yes. Maybe 5 to 7%. 5 to 7% will develop male breast cancer. Okay. Any other family? You said family history means what I wanted you to tell was no first degree relative. What do you mean by first degree relative?
Sir, maternal cousins.
No, when you say first degree relative, it is mother, sister, daughter. That is first degree relative. Mother, sister, and daughter. So I wanted you to tell no history of malignancy carcinoma breast in first degree relatives. That is how you should say family history. Okay.
Yes, sir.
You said mixed diet. What is this mixed diet?
Sir, taking both vegetarian and non-vegetarian diet.
That is called non-vegetarian only.
Yes, sir.
What is the importance of first childbirth?
Sir, more than 30 years is noted to the increased prevalence of breast carcinoma. The breast, first childbirth is more than 30 years.
No, the number of cycles, menstrual cycles, between menarche and first childbirth is important predisposing factor for carcinoma of breast. If the number of cycles are more, there is more chance for carcinoma breast. You have written age, the first childbirth, 21 years. Can you mention two factors which will prevent carcinoma breast or protective factors? Two protective factors.
Sir, pregnancy.
Pardon?
Pregnancy, sir. Pregnancy and breastfeeding.
No. First pregnancy less than 21 years and breastfeeding for more than two years.
2 years.
So breastfeeding for more than 2 years and pregnancy, first pregnancy less than 21 years. Right. That is the important thing. You have written no other comorbidities. no surgeries in the past. Okay, so go ahead. Coming to the examination, any importance for diet? Any importance for diet?
Sir, high cholesterol diet is known to be predisposing for the carcinoma of breast. High fat diet.
It is actually the red meat. Red meat. Especially meat like beef, all those things will predispose, they say. Yes, go ahead.
Coming to the general examination, after taking due consent and explaining the procedure up to the patient, a patient is examined in a well-lit room in the presence of chaperone, and she belongs to ECOG 1 status, and she is conscious, coherent, and oriented to time, place, and person. She is moderately built and well-nourished, with a BMI of 26.2 kg per meter square, slightly overweight. Her vitals are pulse rate is 78 beats per minute, taken in right radial artery, which is normal, in rhythm is normal, and character is normal, and condition of the vessel is normal, and there is no radio-radial delay. And her BP is 128/74 mmHg, taken in right arm, in supine position. Her respiratory rate is 18 cycles per minute, thoraco-abdominal type, and temperature is 98.4 degrees Fahrenheit. There is no pallor, no icterus, no cyanosis, no clubbing, no pedial edema, no generalized lymphadenopathy. And her thyroid and spine examination were normal.
Okay, go ahead.
Coming to the examination of breast lump, on inspection, the first the patient is examined in sitting posture, arms by the side, and comparison to the right breast, left breast is in normal limits. On right breast, there is a shape of the breast is distorted. The mass of approximately 3x4 centimeters is noted in the upper.
I think you should tell that you have examined the patient in the sitting position,
yes,
and
sir.
Arms by the side,
by the side.
Arms elevated.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
On the hips, and then leaning,
yes,
forward, and semi recumbent position.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Right.
There is a mass of approximately 3x4 centimeters in upper inner quadrant at 3 o'clock position, 5 centimeters from the areola, which is ill-defined to note. And skin over the swelling and the skin over the breast is dimpling is seen. And nipple is slightly higher level than the opposite breast and normal in shape. And areola, there is no nodules is seen. There is no scars and sinuses over the breast skin.
Okay.
And examination in sitting posture, arms raised above the head. And left breast is within normal limit, and right breast dimpling became more prominent on elevation, and there is no nipple retraction either. On leaning forward, breast falls equally on both the sides. On contraction of pectoral is major. Sir?
No. What is the purpose of the arms being raised for examination?
Sir, we can see the inframammary region first thing.
Yes.
Inframammary region can be inframammary
Right, inframammary region, and one more thing.
Axilla.
Pardon?
Bilateral axilla can be inspected.
Axilla, visualization of the axilla. Right, go ahead. So anything abnormal in the axilla?
Sir. No swellings noted.
But I am seeing something. I am seeing something in the right axilla. Some swelling in your picture. I don't know.
Yes.
You have examined, but the axilla is full there.
Sir, in palpation, I can find 1x1 centimeter lymph node is there, sir.
Okay, you go ahead. What is the cause for dimpling?
Infiltration of Cooper's ligament, sir.
No, there are two types of infiltration. The growth will spread along the Cooper's ligament. You get something called tethering, and then fixity. Okay,
yes,
after palpation, I will tell you both.
Okay.
What is tethering and what is fixity.
Okay, sir.
Right.
On examination of arms and thorax, there is no abnormality detected, and supraclavicular, bilateral supraclavicular fossa were free.
Okay.
Coming to the palpation, on the palpation of left breast is normal. On right breast, there is no local rise of temperature or tenderness. A single mass of 3x4 centimeters irregular in shape and margins, and it is hard in consistency with restricted mobility. It is moving along with the breast tissue, and the puckering is present. And this mass is not fixed to the muscles or chest wall either. And examination of nipple areola complex, there is no discharge or no lump palpable. This for the mass concern, sir.
And you should look for many things, not only discharge.
Nipple retraction.
What are the things you look for in the nipple? Yeah. Nipple. What is the cause for nipple retraction? What is the cause for nipple retraction?
Ductal infiltration of the tumor.
Ductal infiltration. Okay. So only the recent retraction is important.
Yes, sir.
So you should mention that there is no recent retraction.
Nipple.
Right. Okay, discharge, retraction, any other thing?
Deviation.
Deviation.
Yes, sir. Displacement.
Displacement. So many D's are there. Discharge, yes. Distraction. Right. Okay. Go ahead.
Coming to the examination of axilla. A 1+1 cm lymph node is palpable in the anterior group, which is mobile and firm in consistency.
What is the order of palpation of axillary lymph node?
Sir, anterior group?
No. What is the order of clinical examination? Yes?
Yes, sir.
Continue.
First? Anterior group, sir.
No, it is the central. First is the central, then is the apical, then you come to the anterior or pectoral.
Okay.
So in between the brachial also.
Okay.
Brachial and pectoral. That is the four groups examined from front.
Okay, sir.
Behind, what are they?
Central, apical, anterior, and brachial.
From back, behind. What are the
from behind? From behind, posterior group and supraclavicular group, sir.
No, what is the other name for posterior?
Subscapular group.
Subscapular, supraclavicular, and infraclavicular also. Infraclavicular also from behind.
Okay, sir.
So your finding is?
Yes, sir. There is only one plus one centimeter lymph node in the anterior group, which is mobile and firm in consistency.
What is Rotus node?
Interpectoral group of lymph nodes, sir.
Right. Okay. Go ahead.
And percussion over the sternum, it is a resonant node. And examination of skull and spine is normal.
What is the purpose of percussion of the sternum?
Sir, internal memory nodes, when there is diffusely enlarged, we will get an obliterated dullness.
I don't know. Maybe too much imagination. I don't think. Can you clinically palpate internal memory node?
No, sir.
Yes or no?
No, sir.
So how do you internal memory node?
By investigation.
Which investigation?
Sir, CT thorax only will give the finding of memory.
That is too much, because in which all spaces you get internal memory node?
Sir, we can get it in interclavicular fossa also. Sir, if it is
what are the spaces where you get internal memory nodes? Yes? Yes?
In between the ribs we can get, sir, in the 2, 3, 4.
Second, third and fourth.
Fourth.
You don't get internal memory nodes in all spaces. Only second, third and fourth.
Yes, sir.
And how many percentage of the lymphatics will go to internal memory?
Only 10%, so less than 10%.
It is 15%. That means 85% will go to axilla.
Axillary group of lymph nodes.
Will go to the internal memory. Which part of the breast will go to internal memory?
Upper inner quadrant.
No. To internal memory node.
Areola, is it?
The posterior one third of the breast.
Okay, sir.
Posterior one third of the breast will go to the
internal memory node.
Okay, so I don't think, say, the identification of internal memory node is by examination, ultrasound examination.
Okay.
Nowadays, ultrasound is as an extension of the clinical examination. That is why where they mention most of the places as clinical examination. Clinical examination means not palpable. It is by ultrasound, which is nothing but an extension of the clinical examination.
Okay, sir.
Okay, so any other examination finding? You said you have mentioned axilla. After axilla, any other examination?
Sir, after axilla, arm and thorax, chest wall.
Arm and thorax, and then?
And skull and spine.
Skull and spine. So breast examination is not simply examination of one breast.
Sir, bilateral breast, sir.
Quadrilateral breast.
Yes,
did
sir.
You examine?
But yes, sir. I have mentioned left.
The contralateral breast. Don't say opposite breast. The
yes, sir. Contralateral breast. Okay, sir.
Lateral breast.
Okay, sir.
So, did you examine the contralateral breast?
Yes, sir. It is normal. I have examined.
So, how many percentage of the carcinoma breast you get carcinoma on the contralateral breast?
2%.
Yes.
Sir, how many?
Pardon?
Didn't remember, sir.
3%. 3% do you get bilaterality. Okay, go ahead.
Coming to the systemic examination, Per abdomen examination, there is abdomen is soft, there is non-tender, no lump or no free fluid present, and per rectal there is no abnormality, and per vaginal examination also no.
What is the purpose of abdominal examination?
Sir, to rule out any hepatic mets or Krukken pelvic masses.
In which age group you get Krukenberg?
Premenopausal age group, sir.
So this is postmenopausal. Your patient is postmenopausal. So what is the purpose of abdominal examination? Liver, eh? Liver mets?
Yes, sir, liver mets.
Then what is the purpose of this rectal examination?
Sir, we can get in blumer shell sometimes, metastatic breast carcinoma.
I don't think. Usually, the vaginal exam will be enough, and that is for ruling out
ovarian and endometrial carcinomas.
Ovarian, only ovarian. Okay. Ovarian malignancy, two reasons. Premenopausal, it may be Krukenberg. Otherwise, the associated ovarian malignancy. So pelvic examination is important, but I don't know whether you should look for Blumer's shelf in, because how do you get Blumer's shelf in carcinoma of breast? How do you get Krukenberg?
Sir, there are a lot of theories. Initially, it was proposed like a transcelomic spread, but it is discarded. Nowadays, the hematogenous spread is after the...
Now, why it is not occurring in the premenopausal group? Why not in premenopausal? Yes.
Because it is metabolically active in premenopausal group with vascularity is there, sir. And no, raw surface is there. It was.
Yeah.
The raw surface over the overhang surface.
So how do you get raw surface?
Because it for every ovulation after that graafian follicle will rupture
and it will end into. Right, rupture of graafian follicle, okay, and subsequent you get the raw area.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so I don't think you have to the how it reaches liver. Carcinoma breast.
Sir, hematogenous spread.
Any other method?
Means.
If it is hematogenous, it cannot shed to the pelvis. Any other method?
Lymphatic.
What is the lymphatic drainage method?
Pleural, means there is a trans. What is that called?
Trans.
Diaphragmatic.
No. Lower medial quadrants. What happens to the lymphatics? Or the breast will go to the. A plexus over the rectus sheath.
Okay.
There, it will go to liver.
Okay.
So that is one of the methods of spread of. So liver will be involved in two ways: lymphatic spread and bloodstream spread. Okay. You have written CNS. What is the importance of CNS?
Sometimes the metastatic breast can present as in seizures or skull seizures may be there, sir.
Seizures. Yeah. Any other manifestation of brain metastasis?
Focal neurological deficits. Neurological deficits, sir.
That is no seizures you mentioned. Headache, vomiting. Yes, headache and vomiting. Right. Okay. Go ahead. And what do you get in respiratory system?
Sir, we have to look for that pleural effusion, sir. Majority of times the metastatic breast carcinoma will present as in pleural effusion.
Yeah.
So we have to see the resonance.
So percussion.
Yes, sir, percussion.
Percussion and look for air entry. We don't go for a complete examination of the so system. Yeah. We need examination of abdomen, examination of chest.
Yes, sir.
Rather than saying GI system, all those things. Okay?
Okay, sir.
Go ahead.
Coming to the summary of my case, it is in case of a postmenopausal lady of 45 years, presented with painless right breast lump without any comorbidities, having findings of right upper inner quadrant irregular 4x3 cm hard lump and 1x1 cm right axillary lymph node. And my provisional diagnosis would be carcinoma right breast, clinical T2N1MX.
Now, most important thing right now, I will tell you, there is no MX nowadays.
Okay, sir.
Nowadays, AJCC 8th edition, only M0 okay. And M1.
Okay,
so
sir.
Don't say MX. MX is over. That is okay, one of the major changes in the AJCC 8th edition. M0 only. If you want, okay, you are very particular, you can say M0, no MX. Okay. So T2N1, why it is carcinoma breast?
Sir, because of the starting from the age of the patient, age more than 40 years. Mm-hmm. And
if the age is less than 40, your diagnosis will change or not?
Less than 40 and with the findings corroborating with the findings, the final diagnosis may change, sir. But as of now, my diagnosis won't change based on the age.
So age is not the factor for your diagnosis in this case.
Yes, sir.
What are your findings suggesting a carcinoma? That was my question.
Yes, sir. Yeah. Coming to the findings, it is in 4+3 cm, hard irregular lump with fixed mobility is restricted.
Now the point in favor of carcinoma breast is a hard irregular lump with fixity to breast.
Yes, sir.
With fixity to breast, any lump which is fixed to the breast is a point in favor of carcinoma. Okay.
Yes.
And a palpable lymph node.
Yes, sir.
So, with you said skin dimbling, you are not talking about the skin involvement in your examination. I thought that you will say whether skin is involved or not. So I am asking you whether the skin is involved or not.
Sir, because I can pinch the skin, that's why skin is not involved. Only puckering skin is there.
So what will skin, what finding in skin will change your staging?
Skin ulcerations or nodularity?
Yes.
These two will change the.
Three things. What are the three things?
Ulcerations.
Ulcerations.
Nodularity.
Nodule.
And pseudo orange appearance.
It's called podarach.
Podarach.
So three things. Yes. So are you getting any of these three things?
No, sir.
So if these three things are there, what will be the stage?
T4B, sir. Directly will go to T4B.
T4B. So you don't get any skin fixity in this case.
Yes, sir.
So what is the difference between tethering and fixity?
That I have confusion, sir, but I didn't get a clear answer anywhere right now.
So the early stage, the growth will spread along the Cooper's ligament.
Yes, sir.
So when you move the lump in the diameter of the growth in the Cooper's ligament, there won't be any puckering. But the moment you deviate it from the arc of that diameter, then you get puckering. That is called skin tethering. That is early stage of spread along the Cooper's ligament. But later, there will be extensive growth along the Cooper's ligament and there will be skin fixity.
Okay.
So then you cannot pinch the skin. So skin fixity is a later event in the spread along the Cooper's ligaments.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay, sir.
Right. So now you are saying it is carcinoma breast because of the finding of a hard lump which is fixed to the breast and an axillary lymph node. Yes or no?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Any differential diagnosis for you?
Sir, traumatic fat necrosis, but in this case it is not there because no history of trauma we have ruled out. And chronic breast abscess.
Yes.
And that is also ruled out because the patient doesn't have any features of inflammation or any prior features of lump like that.
Yeah. Yeah.
And
yes. Yes.
And fibroadenoma.
Fibroadenoma. Why you said fibroadenoma? Bhargav, what is the age group for fibroadenoma?
There are 20 to 40 years. I don't know.
No. It is 15 to 30. 15 to 30. So you don't get a fibroadenoma at the age of 45.
But
if at all it is there, it will regress by the age of 30.
Okay.
So at 45, you don't get fibroadenoma.
Yes, sir.
It should be something else. So don't make a diagnosis of fibroadenoma in this case.
Okay.
Because the breast pathology is, most of the pathologies, you have got age group. Fibroadenoma, yes, 15 to 50, or 15 to 30.
30 years.
Carcinoma, what is the age group?
So more than 50 years.
Need not be 50.
Yes, and now it is reducing to
from above 2021. You can get carcinoma.
Yes, sir.
Unlikely to get carcinoma in less than 20, but we have seen.
Yes.
So any breast lump, unless otherwise proved, you have to rule out. That doesn't mean that any breast mouse. What is breast mouse?
Sir, fibroadenoma is called as breast mouse because it is freely mobile in the breast parenchyma.
Yeah, it is freely mobile means even though that terminology is clinically used, it is not very freely mobile from one quadrant to another quadrant.
Other quadrant.
It is not fixed. That is why it is called freely mobile. A lump which is not fixed is called mobile. That is breast mouse. So here I think you should never say fibroadenoma as a differential diagnosis. Traumatic fat necrosis you can say. Can it be a cystosarcoma?
Yes, sir.
What is against cystosarcoma? In your patient, what is the point against a cystosarcoma?
Sir,
the lymph nodes.
Yes, sir.
You don't get a lymph node in cystosarcoma. What is cystosarcoma?
It's a phyllodes.
Phyllodes.
Yes, sir.
Is it a benign condition or a malignant condition?
Yes, it has a spectrum. It ranges from benign, intermediate to malignant.
So that is why it is said that it is neither cystic nor sarcomatous. Maybe benign, maybe you get intermediate and you have got the malignant type also. Cystosarcoma, right? It's called malignant phyllodes tumor.
Right.
So you get bocillated appearance. In this breast, I was seeing some bocillation there. I don't know, you have clinically examined, but by bocillated appearance, big lump, no axillary lymph node, no skin involvement. Here you said some skin dimpling is there.
But yes, sir.
So here maybe it is carcinoma breast, T2N1. Yes. What is the stage?
T2N1 is stage 2.
Stage 2B.
Stage
2. Oh. So it is early breast cancer or LABC or metastatic breast cancer?
Sir, it is an early breast carcinoma.
Eh?
Early breast carcinoma, sir.
Early breast cancer. Yeah, up to which TNM is early breast cancer?
Sir, stage 2. Sir, different books are giving the different definitions. As far as I know, it's a stage 3A is considered early breast carcinoma, but some books are telling that stage 2B also it considered as an LABC.
No. You cannot go on changing like that. Say early breast cancer is up to T3N0, up to 2B only.
Yes, sir.
Three is not early breast cancer. 3A, 3B, 3C are LABC.
Okay.
Okay. It should be clear. Don't say some books are telling 3 also early breast. Don't say like that.
Okay, sir.
You understand? T3N0.
T3N0.
That is up to 2B. That is early breast cancer. So here you are, according to you, clinically it is early breast cancer.
Yes, sir.
Okay. How do you proceed?
Sir, I'll go for investigations like sonomammography and mammography.
No. As a postgraduate, you should say that I will go for triple assessment.
Yes, sir.
Triple assessment. What is triple assessment?
Clinical examination, radiology and pathology.
Clinical examination, imaging, don't say radiology, imaging and the pathological examination. So how do you go about in such a, your clinical examination is over. How do you go, yes. go about? Yes.
I'll go for mammography, sir.
Mammography.
Yes,
what
sir.
Is now, but you have written sonomammography. Why?
In sonomammography, we can characterize the distance from the skin also, sir. From the skin, how much far the...
No, that is not the reason. Nowadays, all cases, you do both. The ultrasound and mammography. So that is why it is called sonomammography. Both are done.
Yes, sir.
So, you do sonomammography. Any other investigation? We will come to it later on. Any other investigation? Yes,
pertaining after to sono? Imaging. After sono, the pathology, sir. After pathology. Pathological investigation.
Which pathology?
Sir, core needle biopsy.
Core needle biopsy. Any role for FNAC?
Sir, definitely role is there to get the axillary lymph node status.
Yeah.
But if clinically palpable lump is there, the better will be go for core needle biopsy to characterize the IHC also.
Suppose the lump is less than 2 cm. Yes.
Still we can do.
No.
Still we can.
Yes. Still.
Still we can go for biopsy, sir. Ultrasound guided biopsy. We can go.
Which biopsy I'm asking? Less than 2 cm.
Excision biopsy.
Because less than 2 cm, very difficult to do core biopsy.
Yes, sir.
So always small lump, less than 2 cm, you cannot do core biopsy. Then it should be either an excision biopsy or an FNAC. Now, what are the problems of FNAC in a breast lump? What are the problems?
Yes, hormone.
Invasiveness and receptor status.
Somebody is vomiting, tell me.
That is the same, sir. Invasiveness we can't see and receptor status means IHC we can't do on FNAC.
No, you cannot differentiate in situ from infiltrating in FNAC. Second point is you have to do the receptor status. Receptor status cannot be assigned in FNAC. But nowadays pathologists are saying they can do in FNAC also, they can do receptor status. But infiltration, in situ and infiltration, you cannot distinguish in FNAC. So that is the advantage of core biopsy over the FNAC. Why you don't do FNAC first or core biopsy first? Yes? Why you don't do core biopsy first? Come on.
First we have to confirm the malignancy, then we can go for that core biopsy.
Pardon?
To confirm the lesion whether it is malignant or not.
Oh, that is why you are doing core biopsy. My question is why you don't do it first?
So it will alter the imaging findings if you do biopsy first and later the imaging.
Yeah, your imaging finding will be distorted by doing needle aspiration beforehand. So that is why always you do the needle biopsies after your imaging. Okay. So what are the likely finding in mammogram in such a patient or suggestive of carcinoma?
Microcalcification, sir.
Pardon?
Microcalcifications.
What type of microcalcification?
Speculated microcalcifications.
No. So you are confusing everything together now. What is micro calcification?
Less than 5 mm calcification are called as
no, 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 no. It is less than 1 mm. So don't confuse micro calcification with speculation. Okay.
Okay, sir.
You understand?
Yes, sir.
Calcification of less than 1 mm is called micro calcification, and the typical appearance is called clustered pleomorphic micro calcification. So that means you get it as a cluster, 3, 4, 5 together, clustered pleomorphic. Pleomorphic means different shapes and size. So clustered pleomorphic micro calcification you get. That is one finding. What are the other findings in mammogram? One is clustered pleomorphic.
Architectural distortion.
No, 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 no. Before that, you said speculated lesion. What is speculation?
Means
what type of lesion you get in carcinoma breast? A denser lesion or a lesion with hypodense lesion?
Denser lesion, sir.
Denser. So you get a radio denser lesion compared to the rest of the breast with border irregularity. And then you get speculations from the borders. Any other finding? Taller than wide lesions. Okay, any other finding? So those are all regarding the lesion as such. Then you get the architectural distortion. Then you get the skin changes, nipple changes, dimpling or retraction. All those things will be evident in what is mammogram?
Low voltage, high amperage X-rays.
X-rays taken in
craniocaudal and medial lateral oblique views.
How many views you take?
Craniocaudal view and medial and lateral oblique views, sir. Medial oblique lateral view.
Oblique view. So two views. Suppose you are allowed to take only one view.
MLO view is the best.
Yeah, medial lateral oblique.
Oblique view.
And you do mammogram one breast or both breasts?
Bilateral breast.
What is the purpose?
Sir, for screening.
No, you can rule out a carcinoma in the other breast. Yes. Second is, you can always compare the lesion. Compare both breasts. So one is to identify a contralateral carcinoma, and second is for comparison. You can put together and compare both breasts. So always you do a bilateral mammography. Will you do mammogram in younger patients?
No, sir.
Why not?
Denser breast. Parenchyma is dense, so we won't get define the lesion in that denser breast.
So cutoff age is, some books say 35, some books say 30. Our institution, they don't do pain people who are less than 35. Some centers below 30, they don't do. So yes, below 30, what is the imaging method of choice?
MRI, sir.
No, 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 no. This only ultrasound. MRI, there are certain indications are there for MRI. So your triple assessment, you have finished clinical examination and sonomammography, and you said core needle biopsy. So what is the purpose of a core needle biopsy other than you said the pathology is there? What else? You have written here
yes,
ER positive, ER negative, HER2 new, Negative.
Yes,
KI,
sir.
What is this KI67? What is that?
It is a proliferative index, sir. How okay, aggressive the tumor is.
Proliferative index. Right. And ERPRHL, one more thing is required. What is it? Grade. What
yes,
grading
sir.
Is this? What grading
Bloom
is
Richardson
this?
Grading. Bloom Richardson grading, sir.
Is a modified Bloom Richardson. Modified Bloom Richardson grade. Grading is the one usually followed by the pathology. Now coming to the back to mammogram, what is Birod's?
The breast imaging reporting and
And Birod's database system.
Data system. Yes, sir.
Database system. Birod's. What were the Birod's in this patient?
It's a 4C lesion.
What is 4C?
Sir, it is 4C means it is a suspicious of malignancy. With malignancy percentage is 10 to 50%.
No, 4C is 50 to 95%. So that is 4C. So here the mammogram report was 4C.
Yes, sir.
You should have projected the mammogram. If it was 4C.
Yes, sir.
The mammogram is with you or not?
No, sir. I couldn't get it.
This patient is from which institute?
Sir, All India Institute of AIIMS Rishikesh, sir.
You are from AIIMS or?
Yes, sir.
Which year you are?
Second year, sir.
Second year. Okay, yes, you are doing MS there.
Yes, MS General Surgery.
MS General Surgery. Okay, so you are after triple assessment, how do you proceed? For such
sir, after confirmation of the diagnosis, I will go for staging investigations.
Right, very good. What is the staging investigation?
Staging investigation in early breast carcinoma.
In this case.
Yes, sir. In this early breast carcinoma, I will go for chest X-ray, LFT.
Yes.
LFT, ultrasound, yeah. Abdomen and the pelvis and bone scan.
No, I totally disagree. There is no need for bone scan in early breast cancer. That is the thing which you should know.
Yes, sir.
Bone scan is done only in LABC stage 3. Why early breast cancer you don't do bone scan? What is the chance for getting a bone scan positive in early breast cancer? Very low.
Very low, sir.
In stage 3, that is LABC, if you do bone scan, there is 25% chance for getting a positive. So that is why in LABC, you do bone scan. Otherwise, if only you clinically suspect, you do. Otherwise, no need for bone scan. If you start yes. doing bone scan for all cases, that is not science.
Yes.
So there is no role for. Have you heard of NCCN guidelines?
Yes, sir.
What is NCCN?
National Cancer Comprehensive Network of USA.
Okay. Yeah, yeah. So NCCN, you should go through that. Guidelines are
yes.
there. So there is no role for bone scan in early breast cancer. So any other investigation other than X-ray chest?
These for staging investigation, sir. If I am proceeding for the surgery, then I'll get all the routine investigations required for surgery.
I think you should say X-ray chest, ultrasound pelvis, I will say. And
yes, sir.
LFT as a screening investigation only. Otherwise, no need even for LFT in early breast cancer. So your investigations, X-ray chest, everything is normal. How do you proceed?
My final diagnosis would be right breast carcinoma, CT2. And sir, I have a doubt here. Yeah, I got an FNC, right axillary lymph node benign. Whether I have to include still it in the clinical staging as N1 or I can do it as an N0?
I think you, without doing your FNAC or the axillary node, it is N1.
Now, what should I present as a final diagnosis? It's N0.
Because in the examination, I don't think you will get a patient with after doing FNAC.
Okay,
you don't get a patient investigated like this.
Okay, sir.
So your diagnosis is, what's the T?
Clinically, T2, N1. T is T2, sir.
T2, N1. What is your final? Sir. Just show, what is luminal A?
Sir, the written, luminal A, multiple classification. It is a molecular classification of breast carcinoma. In that, luminal A means estrogen receptor positive and HER2 receptor negative and low Ki-67 index. In luminal B, estrogen receptor positive and HER2 also positive.
What is luminal B?
ER positive or negative, but HER2 will be positive and high proliferative index, Ki-67 will be high.
Luminal B is ER-PR positive, but the Ki-67 will be very high.
Yes, sir.
In luminal A, ERPR is high and Ki-67 is low. In luminal B, ERPR low and Ki-67 is very high. That is luminal B. Yeah. And what are the other types?
Basal type.
What is it? What is the importance of a triple negative?
It is highly aggressive tumor, sir. Prognosis is bad.
Aggressive tumor. Most of them are grade 3. And?
Yes, sir. It poor prognosis.
It will respond to chemo. That is the importance.
Chemo sensitive.
So, all cases, you do all these things, minimum 5 things you should know pathologically. What are they? ER, PR, HER2 new, Ki-67, and 50 is the grade.
Yes, sir.
Grade. So, 5 things, grade. They are called what? These 5 things are called what? They are called biological markers.
Yeah.
Biological markers, okay? Biological markers.
Okay, sir.
Okay, so now how do you proceed?
Sir, my plan would be right breast conservation therapy.
Yeah.
I will explain to the patient whether she is willing for BCS or to the upfront MRM.
How do you convey that? Yeah.
Sir, many a times in our setup, the patients are not willing for breast conservative therapy. They are going for MRM only.
What is the reason?
Because of the fear lies in the patient that they want to get rid of the tumor. They don't want cosmosis in our setups.
No, that is not the only reason. What about radiotherapy? They may not be willing to undergo radiotherapy. How many days they should go for radiotherapy in breast conservation?
Pardon?
21
grays. 50 GA,
yes,
5 days a week into minimum 4 weeks. So 20 days. So the radiotherapy facility should be available in the same hospital, or the patient's home may be away. Most of the places they don't admit for radiotherapy. So the patient should be willing to come for radiotherapy. You should tell all those things.
Okay.
That radiotherapy facility, patient should be prepared for radiotherapy, to come for radiotherapy, and there should not be any contraindication for radiotherapy. So that is the most important thing which you should convey. Yes, not sir. The cosmos is alone.
Yes, sir.
What is BCT?
Breast conservative therapy. It includes wide local excision or lumpectomy, axillary lymph node dissection, and radiotherapy. Yes.
So three components of BCT.
Yes, sir.
That is one side you say BCT. Second is, yes, what type of mastectomy?
Modified radical mastectomy, Auchincloss type.
Auchincloss. Okay, come to the BCT.
Yes, sir.
How do you, suppose the patient is agreeing for BCT. What is the principle of, why you need mastectomy, Bhargav?
Sir, previously it was thought that it is a localized disease. We have to remove all the loco-regional cancer burden.
What is the principle of the old mastectomy?
The old principle is that there is a continuous spread.
No, it is not continuous spread. Say, pure and simple lumpectomy will be enough for removing the, yes, tumor. But why you are doing mastectomy? Because of the fear of the multicentricity.
Yes, sir.
And also the fear of a tumor recurring in some other place in the same breast. That is the reason why you are doing mastectomy.
Yes, sir.
Why you are doing axillary dissection? What is the purpose of axillary dissection?
Draining lymph nodes should be removed because micrometastasis will be there.
No. The reason is, the most important single bad prognostic factor is the nodal status. In breast malignancy, the most important single bad prognostic factor is nodal status. So you want to know the nodal status. Four or more nodes are there, the prognosis will be bad. So many other bad prognostic factors are there, but the single most important is nodal status. You tell me the other bad prognostic factors for carcinoma of breast.
Poor histology.
Pardon?
Great. Poor histology, sir, like medullary carcinoma, like type of histology.
No, wait. What is the origin of carcinoma of breast?
Sir, either from the ducts or lobules. It depends on that, we can differentiate lobular carcinoma and ductal carcinoma.
No, the origin is called TDLU. Have you heard of it? TDLU.
Yes, sir. Terminal duct lobular unit.
Terminal duct lobular unit. That is the origin of carcinoma breast. Okay?
Yes, sir.
So, then you get the tumor may be either ductal or lobular. Okay? The both will be DCIS, that is ductal carcinoma in situ or infiltrating lobular carcinoma in situ or infiltrating lobular carcinoma. Now the ductal may be DCIS or infiltrating. After, yes, which is the commonest?
DCIS
or infiltrating. The infiltrating is further classified into what? The special type.
Yes, sir.
And
no special type.
NST. What, yes, are the special types?
Tubular, papillary variety, or mucinous variety, medullary variety.
And cribriform.
Cribriform.
Okay, you have mentioned cribriform. Out of which is the least malignant?
Tubular is the least malignant.
Tubular. Why it is least malignant?
It is growing.
Why it is least malignant? The chance for lymph node involvement is less than 3%. So tubular is the least malignant. But I will tell you how many percentage are the special types and how many percentage are NST.
Majority 80% patients are NST only, sir.
So majority are bad.
NST.
Only 15 to 20% is special types. So you come to the other bad prognostic factors.
Lymphovascular invasion.
Yeah, agreed. Other
perineural invasion.
No, perineural and what are the common things you tell first?
Grade, sir.
One is nodal, I said.
Nodal status, grade.
Grade, very good. One more. Age.
Yes, sir.
Age less than 35 is good or bad?
It's bad.
It is bad. Less than bad 35, problem. Bad prognosis. Now, other grade you have mentioned. Any other?
Extension.
Yes?
Extension.
Extension. What is extensive in situ components? What is extensive in situ component? Yes?
Don't know, sir.
If you get in situ, that is DCIS component in a tumor, more than 25% of the tumor is ductal carcinoma, you call it extensive in situ component. Or you get outside the tumor also. So extensive in situ component is a bad prognostic factor. Any other bad prognostic factor?
Necrosis, tumor necrosis.
Ploidy is another bad prognostic factor. Which will be bad? Diploid or aneuploidy?
Aneuploidy,
your basic pathology.
Yes, sir.
So the common things you should say, clinically, if the patient is less than 35, she is going to have a bad. Then of course, pathology is important, the nodal status is important, and then the types, especially HER2, the biological markers, those are all important. So here, according to you, otherwise it is having a favorable tumor type. And
yes,
you are planning for breast conservation or
therapy.
Modified
radical mastectomy.
Yeah. So what is BCT? What is wide excision for BCT?
1 centimeter margin.
Macroscopically 1 centimeter margin. Microscopically?
2 mm margin.
2 mm is not enough. Now they say that the inked margin should be free. That is all. Or maximum, yes, compromise, I will say 1 mm. 1 mm is enough now. So macroscopically, 1 centimeter. What will be the type of incision? How do you put the incision? You remove the skin or not? You remove the pectoral fascia or not?
No, sir. We won't remove the skin unless it is infiltrated. Okay. And we won't remove pectoral fascia. We won't remove pectoral fascia.
Will you reflect the skin flaps?
Yes, sir. We have to reflect.
better not to undermine the skin flaps, and 1 centimeter microscopic margin you remove, and then what you do?
Sir,
most important. No. Most important step now is the specimen orientation.
Yes, sir.
If you don't orient, the pathologist cannot report whether the margin is positive or not. You understand?
Yes, sir.
So
yes,
specimen orientation, marking it superior, inferior, the posterior, medial, lateral is very, very important. Why? Each institution will have a technique of putting some threads so that the pathologist can identify.
Yes,
because
sir.
If the margin is positive, what you do?
Margin positive, we have to chemo also we have to give, sir.
No. You have to re-excise. So some places they take specimen radiography also.
Yes, sir.
See that the entire tumor is out. And some people give wash also. What type of wash? Some tumor residual wash. Like?
I didn't have it up, sir.
Chlorhexidine. Then how do you dissect the axilla? How do you dissect the axilla?
Through the separate incision we can use.
In the axilla. And what will be the level of your dissection?
Up to level 2.
Why not level 3? Why not level 3?
Majority of times it won't go. If level 2 is not involved, level 3 won't be there.
Now, what is the problem of level 3 dissection?
We have to retract the pectoralis minor.
Edema. The upper limb edema is the most important complication of a level 3 dissection. And the edema will lead on to what later on?
Chronic lymphedema of the upper limb, and it will lead to sarcoma, lymphosarcoma over the time, over the period.
Okay. So better to avoid a level 3 dissection, and better to avoid opening up the sheath of the axillary vein. Don't open the sheath of the axillary vein. You limit your dissection just below the axillary vein. Okay, so after a wide excision. Suppose your lump is big and the breast is small, what will be your option?
We can go for oncoplasty, sir. Level 1 or level 2.
Oncoplastic surgery. That should be the answer. So yes, after wide excision, axillary dissection, and then you send the patient for radiotherapy.
Yes.
Isn't it? Suppose it is a modified radical mastectomy. Why it is called modified radical mastectomy?
Sir, it has got lot of modifications from the original Halsted radical mastectomy.
What is Halsted's radical mastectomy?
Sir, in that he used to do extensive dissection. He used to remove pectoralis major, serratus anterior and lower part of the abdominal muscles, including long thoracic nerve and all. So we are coming through that, and we are conserving the axillary vein and long thoracic nerves, and along with the muscles. It has got three modifications.
Who is this he?
Halsted, sir. Halsted used to do all these.
What?
Sorry.
What is the full name?
Henry Halsted.
William Stewart Halsted.
Very good, sir. William Stewart Halsted.
John Hopkins University, USA. He was the surgeon. Am I correct, sir? I think his audio is gone. Is William Stewart Halsted.
Okay, sir. Thank you, Dan.
John Hopkins University, there is something called Halsted's ligament. Have you heard of Halstead's ligament?
Yes, sir. Posterclavicular ligament of Halstead.
Yeah, that is the where you get the level 3. You have to go and dissect, cut that one and go and get to the level 3. That is why sir yes. said don't go there. Since sir yes, is sir. Not audible, with permission of Radhakrishnan sir, I am speaking sir. Radhakrishnan sir?
Yeah, sure sir, but...
his audio is not there, so I am speaking. You read about the famous people, William Stewart Halstead, John Theodore Cocker, who was the first surgeon to win the Nobel Prize, but not for surgery, but for physiology, okay, for the hormones. You read the anecdotes in Bailey and Love. Since till sir comes, I will be keeping engaged.
Do you have any questions, sir, Srinivasan sir, to the candidate?
Yes, sir, I wanted to ask you. You said the FNAC has the right axillary node benign.
Yes, sir.
And you have put the sonomammography findings, mammography findings and all. See, when you present in the, with the permission of Professor, sir, Professor Dayananda Babu, sir, I am speaking to the candidate.
Yeah.
You unmute yourself, sir. He's not muted. Professor Dayananda Babu, sir. Yes, come on.
You have to unmute yourself, yeah.
I think.
Sir, okay. Bob. Oh, yeah.
Sir, yeah. In your absence, yes. I was speaking to the candidate, sir, with your permission.
Yeah, yeah.
Can I speak? Yeah. Can I speak, sir?
Yeah.
See, you are presenting a case in the exam, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
A fresh case. You will not be given with all the investigations. So when you say, you have to say sonomammography, HPE, FNAC, and chest X-ray. The examiners will ask you, what are the findings? You should not put these findings in the thing. Okay. Now you said benign. Lymph node is benign. If the lymph node is benign, what is the next thing you do? Is there anything called sentinel node biopsy?
Yes, sir.
Huh? How do you do sentinel node biopsy?
Sir, peritumor, we can inject methylene blue or isophen blue. Are many methods to do that. You can use ICG or radio colloid technetium albumin.
Mm.
And we can pick up in the axilla, depending upon the modality we are using.
Do you have a name for that node? You have a name for the penis and...
Yes, sir. Cabana node.
Cabana and melanoma. For one, do you have a node? The breast sentinel node is called Giliano. GIULIANOM. It's a Giliano's node. So you have to invest. So if suppose two or three nodes are palpable, the dye takes up two or three nodes at the surroundings. Which do you think is the sentinel node? The node which concentrates more dye is called the sentinel node. So always never put your investigative findings in your presentation.
Okay, sir.
Because some examiners may not like. You have to say what are the investigation you're going to do. And as Professor Babu said, bone scan never in a early breast cancer. If the patient complains of pain, you can take a plain X-ray.
Okay, sir.
Which part of the bone is affected? Which bone is affected?
Vertebrae in that pedicle. First body will affect, then pedicle, and lastly the spinous process will affect.
No, the first spinous process. Then only you go to the body. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Through which vertebra?
Sir, lower. I mean, lumbar vertebra.
Through which veins? Through what plexus?
It goes through the posterior intercostal veins, which drains into Bateson and plexus, and it enters the vertebral
pelvis. What is the peculiarity of Bateson plexus?
It doesn't have any walls.
Yes, right. No problem.
So we'll go back to Babu, sir. Yeah.
Yeah, Babu. Sorry, sir. Taking away time.
No. No problem. So,
you are not online, so I thought I will.
My computer got disconnected. Okay, so now regarding your sentinel node, one more question. You have to choose the blue node or a hot node. You understand? Blue,
yes, sir,
and hot. If you do the radio label, then you have to identify it with what?
Gamma camera, sir.
Gamma probe. Gamma probe. Gamma probe. So gamma probe, that is called a hot node. So blue, yes, node or a hot node.
Hot node.
That is And if it is a radio labeled thing which you are injecting, it should be done the day before.
Yes, sir.
And if it is your blue dye, it is done immediately before the operation. Wait for 10 minutes. Give a massage, wait for 10 minutes. So
yes, sir,
you choose the either a blue node or a hot node. That is the sentinel node. If sentinel node is there, positive, what you do? Sentinel node is positive, what you do?
Then you have to proceed.
Yes, sir. You have to
proceed for axillary dissection.
Axillary, if negative,
sir, we have to.
No need for axillary dissection. Correct. That is the purpose. The purpose of a sentinel lymph node biopsy is, if it is negative, you don't have to do an axillary dissection. Okay, coming back to your Halsted.
Yes, sir.
Halsted was a very aggressive surgeon. When his mother developed acute cholecystitis, he put her in the kitchen table and removed the gallbladder. Such an aggressive surgeon was, the problem is Halstedian concept. He thought that once the disease is confined to the breast and the axilla, if you treat aggressively, you are curing. That was the concept. That is called the Halstedian concept. But unfortunately, it was wrong. So he used to do radical, super radical, removal of clavicle, aggressive surgery. Now the problem of his Halsted's mastectomy was that he removed pectoralis major and pectoralis minor. So what will happen if pectoralis major is removed? Bhargav?
Chest wall deformity will be there, sir.
There will be extensive depression on that side. Big deformity. So that is why nowadays we don't remove pectoralis major or minor.
Minor.
If you remove minor, what is it called?
Patis
mastectomy. If you divide a pectoralis minor, what is it called?
Scanlon.
Scanlon. If you retract, what is it called?
That is pectoralis
minor. So in your institution, we are doing only Auchin class. What is
we are also doing
Auchin
class only.
So, in Auchin class, modified radical mastectomy, what are the structures removed?
The breast tissue, along with level 1 and level 2 lymph node dissection.
Breast means what? You remove pectoral fascia or not?
No, sir, we are not.
No, what actually your answer should be, you always remove the nipple areola complex, along with the skin overlaying the tumor. So you always put an ellipse. You should have said that you will put an elliptical skin incision encircling the nipple areolar complex and the skin overlaying the tumor.
Yes, sir.
And what type of ellipse you put, vertical or transverse?
Transverse ellipse, obliquely.
Transverse, usually transverse, maybe the medial part will be little lower, that's all. Transverse elliptical incision. And then you reflex the flap and then remove the entire breast. What is the extent of the breast?
2, 3, 4 ribs. Superiorly it is extended till the clavicle.
No, that is your dissection. My question is, what is the extent of the breast?
2, 3, 4 ribs, sir. It is extended.
No, it is going up to sixth, second to sixth, not four. What is axillary tail of spans?
It is an extension of upper outer quadrant into the axilla.
Define axillary tail of breast spans.
It is an extension.
Yes.
Sir, it is an extension of upper outer quadrant breast parenchyma into the axilla.
It is an extension of breast to the axilla through a defect in the deep fascia called foramen of Langer. Okay, that should be yes, the sir. Answer by a postgraduate. It's an extension of breast into the axilla through a defect in the deep fascia called foramen of Langer.
Langer. Okay.
What is the importance of this axillary tail of spans?
The axillary tail of spans carcinoma may mimic as an axillary lymph node.
One is it may mimic as lymph node. Second?
Yes.
Second?
Lymphatic.
Sometimes it will present as a swelling and the patient will be having an axillary breast. So yes, axillary sir. Breast may mimic axillary tail of spans.
Yes.
And sometimes a tumor will be there in axillary tail of spans. Why carcinoma breast is more common in the upper outer quadrants?
More dense breast. Density of the breast is more in upper outer.
Not density. Along with axillary tail, that's the largest area of the breast.
Yes.
So that may be the reason. Nobody knows why it is more common in the upper outer quadrants. Especially nowadays, we get tumors everywhere. So that is the, and so you remove the breast, you do your modified radical mastectomy, and you yes, wait sir. For the report. And how do you proceed further?
After the report, histopathology based on the luminal status, luminal class, biological status of the tumor, I'll put the patient on chemotherapy. If it is luminal A, I'll simultaneously give hormonal therapy also, sir.
No, there is no question of simultaneous. Now, this patient needs chemotherapy or not?
Yes, sir.
Or my simple question, what is the indication
sir,
for chemotherapy?
Indications of chemotherapy would be more than 0.5 centimeters with poor histology like lymphovascular invasion or any lymph node. In all the lymph node positive cases, we have to give, sir. Second indication would be more than 1 centimeter tumor. If it is more than 5 centimeter tumor with some conditions like lymphovascular invasion, perineural invasion, these conditions would and hormonal status negative cases. These patients.
Bhargav, now it is changed. It has changed. All okay, node positive need chemotherapy. So okay, that is why in the very beginning, you should tell what is the management yes, means. It is multimodality management, multimodality yes, treatment. Surgery alone is not enough for carcinoma. Why?
Yes,
why patient needs chemo?
Sir, it is believed that it is a systemic disease rather than a localized disease.
So there will be some micrometastasis somewhere.
Yes,
so that is the reason. So systemic treatment, chemo is not given for all patients. T1, N0, there is no need.
Yes, sir.
That is less than 2, no. So yes, more than 2 centimeter, node positivity, always you have to give chemo.
Yes, sir.
What chemotherapy you give?
Anthracycline based chemo means TAC regimen, sir. Taxanes, anthracyclines, and cyclophosphamide.
No, AC. What is AC?
Anthracyclines like doxorubicin and C cyclophosphamide.
So AC, what precaution you will take before offering AC regime?
Sir, AC will cause the cardiomyopathy. So you have to screen for the cardiac status prior to
ejection
the
fraction.
You have to do an echo.
Yes,
before
sir,
giving adriamycin, you should. But you said everything yes, together. Taxanes usually not combined with that.
I agree. Yes, sir.
Because that also is a cardiotoxin.
Yes, sir.
Taxanes. So either AC or
followed by T.
Followed by
T. Taxanes.
Taxanes. So not together. That is yes, very, sir. Very important. Which taxane you will give?
Paclitaxel.
Maybe, I don't know, I have written, but docetaxel is the one which is nowadays given. Docetaxel.
Okay.
So that is the AC regime, usually 4 cycles followed by the taxanes. And so any other chemotherapy, if you read Bailey law, there is a statement. See, what is CMF?
Cyclophosphamide, methotrexate and fluorouracil, sir. It is given previously. Now this is so, the modality. AC regimen is now followed.
So it is written in Bailey, CMF is no more considered as an adequate regime. So CMF yes, is not enough. So they have written yes, one sentence from CMF to pertuzumab. What is pertuzumab?
HER2 new receptor antagonist.
So what is the commonest HER2 new antagonist?
Trastuzumab, sir. Herceptin.
Trastuzumab. And how you give trastuzumab? So you will give it only for HER2 new positive patients.
Yes,
only
sir.
For HER2 new positive patients. How costly yes, is trastuzumab?
The cost, I don't know.
1.7 lakhs.
It is very costly. 1 lakh per injection. And how okay, often it is given?
Weekly for 1 year.
Weekly for 9 weeks, some people give. Or
1 year.
Every 3 weekly into. So it will come to roughly 10 lakhs minimum okay, for a patient. So it is costly or cheap? So, and along with trastuzumab, nowadays they add the pertuzumab also. Yes. Only for, so that is a monoclonal antibody against the HER2. It is also called what? What is the other name for trastuzumab?
Herceptin.
Herceptin. So, Herceptin. So, chemo. Now, you yes, send everything together. You know, what is the sequencing after surgery? There is a sequencing.
Yes, sir. After surgery,
you said hormone, everything together. What is the sequencing?
Okay. Sequence first, we will give for anthracycline AC for 4 cycles, then followed by taxane 4 cycles.
How long you wait for a chemotherapy?
6 weeks, sir. Minimum after surgery, as early as possible, we have to start.
So minimum, you said. It is better to start before 6 weeks. You can go yes, up to 12 weeks.
Yes,
so that is the chemo. After yes, chemo, sir. What do you give?
After chemo, depending upon the hormonal status, if it is ER, PR positive tumor.
No. Next, you have to give radiotherapy. The sequencing is surgery, okay, followed by chemo, followed by radiotherapy, followed by hormone therapy. This is the sequencing okay, of the, what is it called? Adjuvant therapy.
Yes, sir.
This is the, what is neoadjuvant means?
If you are giving before the surgery, it is called as neoadjuvant therapy.
It is also called anterior chemotherapy, the neoadjuvant. Yes. But I am asking adjuvant, the sequencing is always surgery, chemotherapy, radiotherapy
and
hormone. So what are the indications for radiotherapy?
Sir, more than 3 nodes positive.
Okay, nodal positivity. Then?
Yes, sir.
Then?
Then?
Large size of the tumor.
Lymphovascular invasion.
Invasion. Yes, sir.
Yes.
Positive margins.
Positive margins. All LABCs, all LABCs,
yes,
grade 3 tumors. So those are the indications for a radiotherapy.
Professor, so we've got 5 more minutes, Professor.
5 more? Enough?
Minutes.
I need only 5 more minutes. Okay, no? Okay. I'm, so now next is the hormone therapy.
Yes, sir.
What is the hormone treatment of choice? with 5 minutes you should finish or what?
Yes, sir. We have to see the patient status, sir. If it is premenopausal or postmenopausal. Premenopausal women, trastuzumab is the hormone therapy of choice. In postmenopausal women,
my dear, don't mix up things. Trastuzumab is not hormone.
Sorry, sir. Tamoxifen. Sorry, sorry.
Okay. Tamoxifen. You are confused. Tamoxifen. Yes, what is tamoxifen? What is tamoxifen?
Selective estrogen receptor modulator.
Okay. SEMS. Selective estrogen receptor modulator. What is the action of tamoxifen?
Sir, it has a dual action, sir. In breast, it has negative effect on the estrogen pathways, but in the endometrium, it proliferates the epithelium there.
Oh no, in the breast, what is the action of the tamoxifen?
Decrease the proliferation, sir.
No, it has got many actions, but mainly it is anti-estrogenic. You agree? Yes, it is tumoricidal. And it will prevent a carcinoma in the contralateral breast. That is why you are giving tamoxifen. You know that tamoxifen is used for what? Tamoxifen is used for what? Chemoprophylaxis. Have you heard of chemoprophylaxis? You know LCIS?
Yes,
LCIS.
Yes,
what is the treatment of... Yes, what is the treatment of LCIS?
Now it is observation, sir.
You have got three options. Three options. Yes, one is observation. Second is bilateral mastectomy. Third is chemoprophylaxis. You understand? So chemoprophylaxis is by tamoxifen. So how long you give tamoxifen and what is the dose?
20 mg per kg body weight.
Kg?
No, sir, 20 mg. Totally 20 mg per day.
Per day?
For 10 years. 10 years.
Previously it was 5 years, now it is?
5 years. 10 years.
Seconds? Any other hormone?
Sir, if it is a postmenopausal woman, we can give aromatase inhibitors like exemestane, fulvestrant,
letrozole.
The commonest is anastrozole and letrozole.
Yes,
what is the action of the aromatase inhibitors?
It converts, it prevents the peripheral conversion of estrogen, sir.
Aromatase is an enzyme which will prevent the synthesis of the estrogen in the fat. From the androgen, the source of estrogen in postmenopausal patient is this conversion which is happening in the fat, especially in the breast fat yes, everywhere. So that is the role of aromatase inhibitors. And the dose of anastrozole is 1 milligram and the dose of letrozole is 2.5 milligram. So that again you give for how many, how long? Usually 5 years.
5 years.
5 years you have to give the aromatase inhibitors. What are the complications of tamoxifen? I think we will finish with that. Complications of tamoxifen.
Hot flushes.
Most important dangerous complication.
Endometrial carcinoma.
No, that is later on.
Endometrial hyperplasia.
No. Thromboembolic complications. That is the dangerous complication. Thromboembolic complication. Of course, you have got the hot flushes, so many things, vaginal dryness, or depending on premenopausal or postmenopausal, the complications will vary. Yes, but sir. Remember, thromboembolic complications.
Yes,
so, I think Radhakrishnan is appearing. Is it time for?
We have another interesting session. I would have loved this to continue forever, sir, because everybody is so, and you have such a flow of thoughts, and you know, I mean, it's a very complete. But anyway, the
I will come up with your lecture in the next session, sir, whenever it's...
Thank you. Next time I will see that there is no problem. I'm very sorry for the beginning. I think we have lost 15 minutes. Yeah. We have lost. Anyway, Bhargava, it was a very nice presentation. Your presentation was good, but maybe as Srinivasan said, don't show your investigation findings.
Okay, sir. Sure, sir.
A small suggestion, sir. I think Professor sir, there in the bub, sir, you have started with EBC. I think your next lecture will be LABC and MBC. So it will be a continuation for the postgraduates and it will be complete, sir.
No problem. I can do LABC or...
Instead of jumping to some other topic, we can submit the same thing.
That's correct, sir.
You start with the EBC, next could be LABC and MBC. We can finish it up, sir. That is better.
Thank you so much, Bhargava. Thank you, Bhargava. Yes, I only told him last night about presenting a case, and he was very quickly, he was ready and very appreciable, Bhargava.
You are from which place, Bhargava?
Sir, I am from Tirupati.
Tirupati?
Yes, sir.
Tirupati or? Yeah, very nice. Okay, right.
Thank you so much, Babu, sir.
Sir, right now I am doing this in Rishikesh. I am doing Rishikesh, but my name is Tirupati.
Rishikesh.
Aims Rishikesh.
Yes,
sir. Ames. Yes. Who is your HOD?
Sir, Professor Som Prakash Basu, sir. Basu, sir.
Okay.
Som Prakash Basu.
So he's gone from one holy place to another holy place.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for this opportunity, sir.
Thank you. Thank you all.
Thanks, everyone. Thank you all. Right.